Thank you. Yeah. Camel is a kind of animal that takes pleasure in eating dogs. materialistic life is full of thorns, and so one should live only at the prescribed, by the prescribed method of Vedic regulations, just to make the best use of a bad bargain. Life in the material world is maintained by sucking one's own blood. The central point of attraction for material enjoyment is sex life. To enjoy sex life is to suck one's own blood, and there is not much more to be explained in this connection. The camel also sucks its own blood while chewing thorny twigs. The thorns the camel eats cut the tongue of the end of the camel, and so blood begins to flow within the camel's mouth. The thorns mix with fresh blood, create a taste for the foolish camel, and so he enjoys the thorn-eating business with false pleasure. Similarly, the great business magnates, industrialists, who work very hard to earn money by different ways and questionable means, eat the thorny results of their actions mixed with their own blood. Therefore, the Bhagavata has situated these diseased fellows along with the camels. The ass is an animal who is celebrated as the greatest fool, even amongst the animals. The ass works very hard and carries burdens of the maximum weight without making profit for itself. The ass is generally engaged by the washerman whose social position is not very respectable, and the special qualification of the ass is that it is very much accustomed to being kicked by the opposite sex. When the ass begs for sexual intercourse, he is kicked by the fair sex. Yet he still follows the female for such sexual pleasure. A henpecked man is compared, therefore, to the ass. The general mass of people work very hard, especially in the age of Kali. In this age, the human being is actually engaged in the work of ass, carrying heavy burdens and driving tila and rickshaws. The so-called advancement of human civilization has engaged a human being in the work of an ass. The laborers in great factories and workshops are also engaged in such burdensome work, and after working hard during the day, the poor laborer has to be again kicked by the fair sex, not only for sex enjoyment, but also for so many household affairs. So Srimad Bhagavatam categorizes Srimad Bhagavatam categorization of the common man within any spiritual enlightenment into the society of dogs, hogs, camels, and asses is not at all an exaggeration. The leaders of such ignorant masters of people may feel very proud of being adored by such a number of dogs and hawks, but that is not very flattering. The Bhagavatam openly declares that although a person may be a great leader of such dogs and hawks, disguised as man, if he has no taste for being enlightened in the science of Krishna, such a leader is also an animal and nothing more. It may be designated as a powerful, strong animal or a big animal, but in the estimation of Srimad Bhagavatam, he is never given a place in the category of man on account of his atheistic temperament. Or, in other words, such godless leaders of dogs and hog-like men are bigger animals with the qualities of animals in greater proportion.
And the dog will bark.
Então, você vai come here. I'm already here. You go some other place. So the dog wants to have some shelter. So the same way, people probably describes how people go for education and they will study and get so many degree qualifications. But at the end of it, what do? They have to go and bang. They study for so many years and take so many exams and so much anxiety to pass these exams and pay so much money for fees, for college education. And at the end of it, they have to go and beg. And they go to beg from the big bosses and they will say, my dear sir, please give me a job. I will be a dog for you. You actually become the dog of the boss. You become like their dog. Just like sometimes you will go to people's offices and you want to see the boss will tell the secretary, send them away. The boss won't come. He'll just tell his secretary, get rid of them. You know? Get rid of these people. They come to get my money. So, like that. So, he uses his secretary. Secretary is like a dog. And they will say, no, no, he's busy, he can't see you today. Like that. So, people study college education, get degrees, just to become a dog. Somebody's dog. And then they become a bigger dog. And a bigger dog. You're still a dog, whether you're a big dog or a fat dog or a little dog or a skinny dog, whatever, you're a dog. And the dog's business is the same. So people are like hogs, dogs, and camels. The camel likes to eat the thorns. In the desert, the camel will eat thorns. And when it chews the thorns, then it will cut its own tongue and it tastes the blood. And the camel is so stupid, he doesn't realize that he's tasting his own blood. But when he's eating the thorns, he's thinking, oh, these thorns are very nice. He's tasting his own blood, but he's thinking the thorns are very nice. And this is compared to people that working hard in material life, particularly in family life. They're thinking, well, this is very nice, I'm very happy. They're actually suffering, but they're thinking very nice. And then you get people also who do a lot of business, and they're working, trying to make money and cheat people and so on. So they enjoy the thumbing results of their work. They work lying and cheating. You know, the whole business is all lying and cheating. Sometimes people who have shops and so on, you sell goods there in the shop. You tell people, oh yeah, this is very good. Oh yes, this is very good quality. And you know it's rubbish. Make some place fake. It's all lying and cheating, the whole business world. You go to the shops and purchase something. They say, oh, very nice. This is very good. From Germany. It's made in China. So this way, people are compared to camels, because the camel is tasting its own blood. So the same way people are tasting their blood, because the business of sex is to give your blood. Semen is made from blood. And the blood, just like to make semen, it takes a lot of blood. And to make blood, you have to eat food. If you don't eat food, you won't produce blood, and if you don't have blood, there will be no semen. So, people have to eat more in order to satisfy themselves sexually. So the camel is like that. Camel is also working hard to enjoy its sex life. And then the ass, hogs, dogs, camels, and asses. Asses, the ass is so stupid that he carries a heavy load every day. Because he thinks, if I don't carry this load, I won't get my grass. But everywhere grass is growing. The animal doesn't need to carry the grass. So grass is growing everywhere. But the ass is so foolish that he's thinking that I have to carry the grass. Otherwise, I have to carry this. Otherwise, I won't get any grass to eat. And the ass is also a victim. When he approaches the female ass, he will approach the female ass to enjoy some sex, and the female donkey will kick him. And he's thinking, oh, very nice. She kicks very nice. And she's being kicked in the face, and he's thinking, oh, she kicked me very nice. So this is the nature of the animal society. And the donkey, the ass is also the prey. They make a sound, you know, they make horrible sounds. And people think, oh, that donkey, that ass, making so much noise, horrible noise. Why doesn't he stop it? But the ass is thinking, my singing is very nice. My singing is very sweet. So this is the nature of the animals of civilization. And they're all doing these kind of different activities which are very foolish. Because they're animals, they're not humans. So there's a difference between human being and animal. The human is meant to have intelligence, it's meant to understand, and it's meant to make proper use of the human life. The animals are just stupid. They're just foolish creatures. They don't have the intelligence of the human being. So the animals, they just do their animal things. Eating and sleeping and mating and defending. That is the animal business. But the human life is meant for something more than just being animal. The human life is meant for investigation into the absolute truth. The human life is not meant to be wasted. It's meant to be used for the perfection. But if we just live like animals, eating and sleeping and mating and defending, then who do we praise? We will praise the people who are big animals, the people who are big eaters, who are big in sleeping, and who are big in mating and defending. We think, oh, he's very great. Oh, he's very great. He could eat so much. Oh, he could sleep so much. He's a great man. Oh, he could have many wives and many children. He is a great man, very expert in having family members. Just like we had this one family there in Bahau. There was a family living next door to our temple. The man there had seven wives. He had seven wives and quite a number of children. He was a good man, actually. He was a good man. He gave donations for the temple. But his seven wives, they all live together. So people like that, you know, we know Krishna had many wives. Kings would have more wives. Maharaj Janak had 360 wives. No, Maharaj, who was it? Dasara, Maharaj Dasara, 360 wives. So like the kings, they have the wealth. They have all these, they can maintain all these wives. But that's just the business of the animals. Like the monkeys. You can see that the monkeys, they will have many wives and many children. In Vrindavan, you can see all the different monkeys. So this is the business of the animals, eating and sleeping and making and defending. Actually, we're not against polygamy. Polygamy means you can have more than one wife. Because Prabhupada said, if people will have more than one wife, it means other men, they are free to go for self-realization. They can be free. But if you have just one man, each man, one wife, then there's so many women they need to get a husband. And then it becomes a problem for the women if they're not married. When the women are married, it's good, they're taken care of. But when they're not married, then it's a problem. And so, for men who are qualified, you can have more than one wife. But, of course, now in this, it's not allowed in this society. So even some devotees, they want you to do that. They want you to have more wives. But Prabhupada said, no. This is not allowed. We don't want that. Anyway, the mating business goes on. People who are like hogs and dogs and camels and asses. They will engage in these kind of activities. They will engage in the animal life. And the heroes, the people they look up to, are the people who are big eaters, drunkards, womanizers, we think, oh, they're very big. He's very successful. Just like there are some companies you go to, if you can smoke a lot and drink a lot, they like you. They want you in their company. Oh, you can smoke so many cigarettes every day, and you can drink so much every day. We want him in our company. He's good for our company. We want him in our office. He can drink a lot and he can smoke a lot. We want that. So, this is, people are attracted somehow to this thing. They think, oh, it's very great. Oh, he had so many wives. Oh, he had so many women. He enjoyed so many women. He's a great womanizer. Oh, he's a great man. Successful man, you should have. They don't think he's a debauchee. Actually, he's a debauchee. He's a, lumpada. In the Shikshasika, said lumpada. Lumpada, womanizer. So Srimati Radharani, she said, even if Krishna is a womanizer, but still, if it makes him happy, then I'm. Because Lord Krishna's position is very special. Just like one time there was this American professor, he came to meet Prabhupada, and this professor said to Prabhupada, he said, how can you worship a god who is an adulterer? Adulterer means somebody who has more than one wife. If you have more than one wife, that's adultery, that's a crime. In the Western world, that's a crime. In the Islamic tradition, it's allowed because some Arabs are very rich, they can maintain many wives. But even in Islamic tradition, they have to get permission from the first wife that she's now that you can have another one. They get permission. So, but in Western society, it's not allowed. So this professor said to Prabhupada, how can you worship Krishna He's an adulterer. He enjoys so many women. And Prabhupada said to him, it is you who are the adulterer. All women belong to Krishna. All women belong to Krishna. So this way Prabhupada enlightened this professor that actually you think Krishna was an adulterer. You were the adulterer. Some people don't realize they're guilty of what they're accusing Krishna of. They're saying, oh, Krishna was a model. They're the ones who are a model. They don't see their own faults. This is often a problem that we're so busy looking at others, we don't look at our own self. We don't see our own faults. So it's very important that devotees should be introspective, not extrospective, not extrovert, but introvert. Look at our own self and see our own faults and our own frailties, our own problems, and don't be so much busy to criticize others. So this is important. And so Swami Kadishi is saying that these people who are like hogs, dogs, camels, and asses, they will praise other men who are big hogs, who are big dogs, big camels, and big asses. Big hogs eat everything. Oh, he's very great. He ate everything. He ate snakes, he ate dogs, he ate. Prabhupada said there are animals who can do that. Animals, some birds, they can eat stones. They can digest even a stone. You know, if we try to eat stones, they'll get stuck in our system. Big problems. Jagannath Prabhu was telling me that his sister's boyfriend is in hospital just now. He's got stones in his kidney. They have to remove the stones from his kidney. Now, we cannot digest them, but they're birds. They can digest some stones. Some birds. So there's food for the animals and food for people. What is proper food for people? People have to learn what is proper food. So fruits and grains and vegetables, they're provided for people. You don't need to eat animals and all kinds of things like that. That is not the proper food for the human body. And Prabhupada said, we have two carnivorous teeth, which are meant for tearing the meat. There's the only two. If you look at the dog or the tiger, their teeth are all carnivorous. They're all for tearing. They don't chew anything. They just swallow. And then they pass very quickly. But the human body is different. The human body, our bodies are meant for chewing and grinding, and the food passes through the body very slowly. So if you eat the wrong food, then you get indigestion. You get stomach problems. You eat food which cannot digest properly, then you get problems. So we have to be very careful to eat, but don't eat too much. Don't eat too little. Eat sufficiently. And eat food which is nourishing, which will give you strength and vitality. Don't just eat only for the taste. We're so concerned for the tongue. We like the taste. We want to have a nice, that nice taste. It should be sweet.
or it should be very spicy. One devotee, I know, he went to Australia to study. He said, oh, it's so difficult here. There's no tamarind rice. He was missing so much, his tamarind rice. So, you have to understand the nature of the body. Don't get attached to just only the taste, but eat food which is proper, which is nourishing, and which is healthy and satisfying, which promotes a mode of goodness. Don't eat all the passionate things. Otherwise we become like the hog and the dog with service mentality. And the dog is a man's best friend. Some people, they have, for some people, the dog is their best friend. I saw this lady, my lady was holding her dog. She's holding this dog. Just like a baby. Other ladies were holding children. She was holding this dog. An old dog. So become the servant of the dog. The dog serves, and other people are serving the dog. So we don't want to be dogs. We don't want to worship dogs either. We don't want to worship people who are like dogs. We have to understand what is human life. Okay, any question?
Hey Krishna Guru Maharaj, always Sushila Prabhupada. I have a question, but not regarding today's verse, but anyhow just related to Srimad Bhagavatam. As we can find that one word which is mentioned by Srila Prabhupada is Haitava Dharma.
Haitava Dharma?
Yes, as meaning as cheating religion. So does that mean that anything indirecting us from away from Krishna, that is concluded as Haitava Dharma? Sir Maharaj?
Yes.
So in that manner, can we conclude that the worship of demigod also falls under Haitava Dharma?
Yes. It depends on the mentality. The people can also worship demigods knowing that they are demigods and they are not supreme. So if you worship the demigods knowing that they are part of the Supreme Lord and that they are servants of the Supreme Lord, then it's alright. Then it's not Haitava. But if you worship the demigods thinking that they are independent and they are supreme on their own, then that is Haitava. Yes, any other question? Yes, ask. What's your question? Okay.